Praise the Lord, my dear beloved brothers and sisters. Warm welcome to one and all of you, and I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. As always, I am feeling very happy, delighted that we are able to meditate from the Word of God, which very few people get as privilege. And I'm a strong believer in what we do in this room. And without a doubt, I can tell you there are many people missing this. Many people want to meditate, but then they are not able to. And that's why, blessed are you who get that opportunity to meet on the principles that our Bible is teaching us. And why this is important is because this is the only source where you could learn many, many aspects which require, corrections from your life. Yeah, the spiritual deeds are going to change and your spiritual values are going to improve and so many other things. Yeah, you don't want to miss on that. The reason is because that's the only gift that we have from the Bible, that it always teaches us to improve in life. But it's your personal decision where you don't want to march ahead in your life. And God is not able to do anything about it. Why? Because it's your free will. But to a large extent, He continues to chastise you, he continues to admonish you, he continues to exhort you, he continues to permit many problems in your life so that you will someday somehow realize it. That's the only attitude. He's a good father. Yeah, and there can't be anyone better than our good father. He's a great father, good father, loving father, compassionate father, 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 father. Okay, warm welcome to this series where we are dealing on this concept of authority. We started to discuss from the book of Mark, chapter 1, verse 21 and 22, where Jesus enters into a region called as Capernaum, and there he starts to preach and teach in the synagogue, and every one of those who listen to that teaching couldn't believe with what authority this guy is preaching and preaching, and unable to accept the fact that this guy is not trained one, and this guy did not graduate, and this guy he lacks in basic sense, and moreover they had no respect for him because they called him as they still had their doubts over his birth. They did not believe that he was conceived of the Holy Spirit. See, if they have rejected Jesus, obviously they rejected the secret of his birth. And no doubts about it. And Jesus, of course, he was hurt whenever they call him illegitimate child and all that. You can imagine, right? But Jesus overcame those emotions and he stood for you and me. That's why we need to bow before this great name. By all means, he went through harassment, suffering, and it's for you and me, beloved. Nothing else. Okay, on the same lines, we had been dealing with many, many valuable lessons and teachings from the Word of God that we start to discuss from the different perspectives of the Bible. And then we went through so many lessons already from the Word of God. I don't have time to recap, but the recent lessons are we learn from the life of centurion how he spoke on the lines of authority and how he behaved on those lines of authority, and that understanding on those lines of authority got transformed to something called as faith. And he didn't know that it was called as faith until Jesus were to exclaim, turning around to all the people, "Hey, did you notice? I've never seen anyone like this in the entire land of Israel." That what a faith he has. Yeah, that's the most important thing which you and I need to really understand, nothing like getting that appreciation and the certificate from the hands of God. Never ever get carried away when men appreciate you, because the next day they're going to pull you down, or maybe the next hour itself they're going to say you are bad. And those appreciations are not purely from spiritual perspective. Those are all like looking at the circumstance. You are successful, they appreciate. You fall down, they immediately depreciate or lead you into depression, because the words would be so hurtful, and the same mouth which praised you would not even think twice to curse you and hurl blows. And that's why I'm a great believer of listening to the voice of God. God, what do you think about this achievement? God, what do you think about this success? God, what do you think about this thought of mine? What do you think about this deed of mine? What do you think this reaction of mine, the action of mine, is something that I would want to always listen to God's voice. I need His feedback more than any man's feedback. But by saying that, I don't ignore people. And that's why I'm talking to all of you, and I welcome, right? I keep telling you, you're welcome, my brothers, my sisters, to test my spirit. What kind of spirit I possess? Huh? Is my spirit partnering with Holy Spirit? Then you will hear everything from the Word of God as it is. I would neither decrement or increment. I would be led absolutely how the Holy Spirit leads me, and you can feel it. You will feel that I have lit a fire in your heart. We discussed, right? On those people on the road of Emmaus, that Jesus met with those two guys. We did that all that recently, right? All the studies. And then we spoke from the life of Noah, who didn't have much of the predecessors from whom he could learn, or ancestors whom he could learn, only except Noah and Abel, who lived for a few years, and they were taken up by God. One was dead and the other one was taken alive. So Noah was left with not much of examples or use cases or studies, role models, nothing. And we spoke from his life, right? Why? Because these are the guys who always paid attention to God's voice, or they tuned their ears, their spiritual heart as ears, you know. That those who have ears, let them hear. Jesus keeps saying this. Many people think it's the two big ears on their head. No, it's the ears of your heart. Your heart, the inner man, right? Soul has ears, eyes, everything. And whatever he feels, whatever he looks, whatever he perceives is what the external person does as an action. It proceeds from him. Yeah. And it's the spirit who basically does things in partnership with the evil spirit or Holy Spirit, it would reflect as a deed externally. And that's why these kind of lessons are very important, to check on the quality of your spirit, the condition of your spirit, the spiritual health. Yeah. It's like a checklist. This is our 24th session, I think. Yeah, this is like a spiritual checklist where you can definitely run it against your life, run it against your actions, reactions, the words of your mouth, and places you visit, and people whom you associate with, and what kind of language you use when you're in tense moments, and when you drive the vehicle, do you get into road rage? So many things. It's like running a checklist. And every single session is like, it constitutes to one or other checklist. And therefore, when you go through this checklist, you will get a lot of light on the real who you are. And you will understand that God called you for this purpose, that you need to come to light. You need to repent. You need to reconcile. You need to once again be replenished and rejuvenated with the fresh energy of God, the fruit of the Spirit, and the gifts of the God, the spiritual gifts of God will have to descend upon you. This is His desire for every mankind, not just the believers. Even the unbelievers will have to come to Him. In fact, His eyes are more on the unbelievers than believers. Because why? They never got an opportunity. They are like that one sheep which was lost. And Bible says very clearly in the parable of the lost sheep, or in the lost coin, His eyes are over those lost people. And that's why don't ever judge such people, right? Unbelievers. Have that burden in your heart to pray for them. Pray over their disbelief and stuff like that. And may God bless you. All right. So warm welcome again to this series where we are learning the principles from the law of authority and every doctrinal study that we could possibly debate and discuss and meditate together, we are trying our best. Yeah. And we started initially to discuss about the unclean spirit. You take lesson one and lesson two, you will see the intention was to get into the side of unclean spirit and deal a little bit of meditations with that doctrine and all that. But I could not even step into Mark 1:23. I stopped in Mark 1:21 and 22. Yeah, sometimes Holy Spirit asks me to apply the brake and I apply the brake. Same thing happened with Body, Mind, Spirit and Soul series, where I started the series, lesson one and two. In that series also, you can listen. I would have kicked off that series to talk through the different forms of the heart, fragile heart, panicking heart, strong heart, hard heart, furious heart, all these things. So I thought I will touch a little bit on the basics of Body, Mind, Spirit and Soul. And you believe me or not, 87 sessions I've spoken there and I'm not yet done. It's like the journey through the entire Bible and it's just bubbling. Then I thought I will apply a brake and temporarily park that vehicle and come back here. Why? Because I have to cover other concepts. It's a pretty busy schedule for me. And pray God for our part-time ministry and we got to preach and teach everything we could possibly. One life, I want to give my best to my God and to my fellow brethren and sisters. So should you be. All right, so today's meditation, we are going to continue to meditate on the lines of authority, right? Many people, when they think on that authority and the powers that subside within that authority or associated with that authority, they tend to think authority means it's like commanding. I'm a commander. Some people behave like that in the church, in the family. I'm that commander. I'm that army general. Right? Some people, parents or husbands over wives and wives over husband, it happens both ways. Or the parents over the children, commanding authority, come here. How many times did I tell you that you shouldn't be getting into this? Huh? Why did you do this again? Yeah, for some children, you need to really whack them through words, which is better than whacking them with a stick. If required, you can whack with a stick also, Bible says. Because why? The back of the fool deserves for the back of a stick, actually. And that's not the proverb, because it's also the truth, because some children, they don't listen. They don't tend to fall in this line of obedience. Therefore, they need that little bit of whacking, which is better for them rather than they falling in the pit of the hell or the bottomless pit or the lake of fire. So parents who are listening to me, don't get any nasty ideas. Okay, brother, you told me this. Today you will see how I'm going to swing my stick around my son's body or something like that. No, that's harassment. I'm not asking you to beat him to death. So just give that whack once or twice and just let him feel that next time he's going to be mischievous, he's going to get that whack. No, next time it's like they train that cub lion from the tender age. Yeah, they give that electric shock once or twice, and from that baby until it becomes a big mighty lion, looking at whom the whole jungle gets scared and threatened and all that. This fellow, the moment this big mighty lion before whom that ringmaster lifts up that stick, which is that electrical shock stick which he gave initially, right? And this guy goes and crumbles down with fear. Humbly he stands before the ringmaster. One blow, actually the ringmaster would be torn into pieces. That's the power of lion, or that's the might of the lion or lioness. You've seen in the circus, right? Same principle applies here. And each time he doesn't beat the lion, each time he doesn't give the electrical shock, maybe 3 or 4 times they do that. Sometimes you need to apply that principle on your child, but I'm not encouraging even that. 2 or 3 times you should beat. Please try to advise your children in a soft way. Teach them the statutes of God, for which you got to be a role model, brother. If you are a role model in conduct, in speech, and love, and purity, and faith, 1 Timothy 4:12, your life gets easier. I don't think your child will be rebellious. I don't think your child will be such a person who is mischievous. This is not possible. If you are a person who lifts a stick and wants to beat the child, which means you have a problem to fix in your life. I'm not a strong believer in beating the children. But still, what Proverbs said is what I'm saying. But that's Old Testament. New Testament, of course, anything is possible in Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things in the Holy Spirit who helps me. I can definitely teach the right things to my child and he's going to understand. Okay, so on the same lines, many people think that authority is nothing but like commanding and taking control and dictating, dictatorship role, and talking to anyone in that military language. See, even the military fellow centurion, right? He did not talk in military language to Jesus. He bowed before him and he said that, "I'm pleading you, heal my servant." Because why? We have discussed that in the few sessions ago, right? Because he had a fair understanding of who this Jesus is, what kind of authority he is exercising and powers he possessed from above, and what he delivered. The output was full of love, compassion, mercy, forgiving sins, healing people, blessing the poor, running in search of downtrodden, running in search of needy, and all his parables, teachings. He was not able to believe. Can someone who is under such an authority is able to behave like this? That touched his heart, and therefore he marched all the way to this Jesus. And he, because he has learned enough, which many believers haven't learned yet from the word of God or with the help of the Holy Spirit. Centurion had neither of these. And he was a Roman fellow and he was a paganite. He didn't have any understanding. Right? We learned from his life too. Even that guy would not use that military language because I think he had a fair understanding of who this Jesus was all about. So, what I'm trying to say here is never ever correlate this authority in that commanding language, taunting language, blowing hurt, and condemning people and gossiping and sledging, slandering. They think, yeah, these are the methods to correct this brother. These are the methods to correct this sister. Why? Because we have received that authority from God to be the preacher and teacher and admonishing of God's word, and through exhortations we need to lead this brother and sister. Correct. But then your words must be seasoned with grace. You can do all of this, but never forget that you are given other doctrines too. How you should present those admonishing words and exhortations. Where is it written? Colossians chapter 4, verse 6. One of my favorite verses, and I try to practice every time. Most of the times I am successful, few times I do fail. Very tough. Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt. You eat food without salt, how it tastes? It tastes horrible. Yes, all of us know the answer, right? And you don't want any food without salt. Likewise, God doesn't want to hear any word without grace. And if you speak anything without that grace, words of condemnation, words of gossip, words of murmuring, complaining, sledging, slandering, secret envy, bitter envy, all of these, you know how it sounds? God doesn't taste anything in you. In fact, he feels like as if he just now had that bitter gourd juice. Yeah, the bittersome of the bittermost vegetable is that bitter gourd, and therefore they name that with the same name, which is reflects the taste. In fact, given a choice, what is that? That is a vegetable, right, which is long like a snake. It's a creeper, I think. I forgot the name. I would rather call it a snake vegetable or something, but they gave a different name. But some vegetables, they really match up to the name. Anyway, we are not here to discuss on the vegetables. Coming back to the original point, Colossians 4:6, let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt. Salt means what? Tell them very kindly. Tell them lovingly. Tell them compassionately. Yes, your admonishing words could be sometimes very straight and sharp and plain and clear. Agreed. But there is a mannerism to present. You need to learn from the life of Jesus. How many incidents? You read all the four books. You will just know how we not how we dealt with the Pharisees and all that, who were hypocrites. Hypocrites are the ones who say always, "We are righteous. How dare you say that I'm a sinner?" He knows how to be shrewd with a shrewd. Yeah, if you're smarting, if you're very smart and over smart before God, He also knows how to conduct in the similar way and teach you better lessons, make you bite the dust, and then feel that you're worth for nothing. This is exactly what Pharisees went through. Finally, they accused Jesus falsely. Yeah, and they corrupted the mind of Judas and made him to betray his master and all that. They couldn't capture Jesus in a most rightful way or in the righteous way. They were crooks. They were a bunch of politicians. Can you imagine? The high priest, the chief priest, and the people who preach the word of God behaving even worse than a politician. This is where the self-righteousness and the self-prejudice will take you towards. And this is how Lucifer became devil. This is how Job had to go through that painful situation where God will have to allow a few incidents in his life, terrible incidents, although, to get him out of that self-righteous behavior. But Job was pretty new to this doctrine, right? He didn't have synagogue or word of God. Moses was not even born. No book of Moses, no laws of Moses. Yeah. The law came through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus. John 1:17 was missing in his life. So Job, don't blame him. Job himself went through this. You are not Job, brother. You are more than Job. Trillion times more than Job. Aren't you ashamed that you are picking an example which is like 5,500 years old? He lived in the first 500 years. The world is 6,000 plus years now. Are you not ashamed? I am ashamed. Not of you, of me. I'm no one to judge you or condemn you, my brother. I love you. Yeah. I condemn myself. I judge myself. Before God judges me in that white throne, it'll be too late for me to rectify my problems and errors. This is my chance. Yeah. That you may know how to answer each one. Actually, this is again not my meditation verse. Somehow I traveled and met up with this verse, and I need to really speak on this before I get into the actual meditation verse. But I'm talking very much in line. So you can be sure I'm talking in connection to what we are going to meditate together from the book of Matthew chapter 9. My original point was never ever think authority and the law of authority, the principles of authority, the powers that subsides within the authority translates to a dictatorship and rough voice and rude language and arrogance and being very strict and measuring somebody with an iron rod. And yeah, I am measuring somebody with an iron rod means what? Last time you bet them 10 times. This time you are little okay. I bet you only 8 times. Not like that. Who are you to punish somebody? Tell me. Who are you to condemn somebody? Who are you to judge somebody? You got to speak to every one of the brothers and sisters who are sinners or believers, unbelievers, thinking of the fact that you are just like them. All your righteous deeds are filthy rags before God. You are a garbage too. But then you're such a blessing to the brothers and sisters, an instrument in the hands of God, that you're able to help them to get the right things preached and taught. Okay. So then what are you saying, brother? Is it the question you put right in front of me? Yeah. That's the reason why we want to pick up this verse or scripture. Matthew chapter 9 verses 1-8 will be our meditation verse today. If time permits, we will also deal with another scripture from the book of Mark. We will see how it goes. I hope you understood that the law of authority doesn't translate to the dictatorship kind of role and speaking in that tone of authority and all that, but also it has a mellowing side. It has a soft side to it. It has a soft corner to it. And that's exactly what we are going to discuss from this incident, what happened between Jesus and a paralytic man in the book of Matthew, chapter 9, verses 1-8. So he got into a boat and crossed over and came to his own city. And behold, they brought to him a paralytic lying on a bed. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said to the paralytic, "Son, be of good cheer, your sins are forgiven you." So Jesus gets into a boat and he asks people to row the boat, and he travels for some distance to meet this paralytic guy. Because why? He has got an important message to, or an important doctrine to be preached rather, where people shouldn't look at him only as the miracle worker. Yeah, sometimes this authority with which you exercise shouldn't convey that message to the people that your outlook is full of dictatorship and you are just limited to certain roles and duties and responsibilities, and you're not able to convey the real meaning in that authority through which you are exercising the powers given to you, the gifts given to you by God. I'm talking to all the miracle workers, right? Although you focus enough to perform miracles for God in the name of Jesus, I'm talking about the true miracle workers, not about this corrupt miracle workers where all these gimmicks are happening even today. I have heard few of them, but I just don't have any evidence to prove that it is true or not. Yeah, they appoint certain people, this corner, that brother, that corner, this brother, and when I call out such name, you should come out saying that you are lame acting, and then I will call out in the name of Jesus, speaking in tongues, and lay my hands, and you will start to walk. Yeah, it's all like predefined, and they appoint certain actors, and they're exactly called as false prophets. Yeah, so I'm telling you, Bible doesn't talk about this doctrine of where you need to look for miracle workers. That is meant for people who doesn't have enough faith, and there are a lot of true believers. Or brothers, I would say rather, miracle workers who receive that gift to serve others and to encourage people and build up that faith. One miracle is good enough to build up that brother's faith. God appoints you to conduct that miracle in somebody else's life. Therefore, their faith just comes to life. And you are the true brother in Christ. But there are false preachers and false teachers. That's why my recommendation and Bible's recommendation to every one of you: don't go in search of any miracle workers in Christ. Rather, you search the Christ himself, who is the miracle working God. In the name of Jesus is enough. Like how that centurion said, "Oh, I'm not worthy for you to come under my roof. Just say a word, Jesus. That's enough, because I have all understanding. The power is given to you from that authority whom you serve, whom you bow, that is Father in heaven. I have complete understanding and I have faith. You don't have to work on that miracle for the second time. That's enough. A word will do. Come on, tell me, Jesus. I mean, speak out, Jesus." And Jesus turned around and he said, "I'm amazed with this guy. Who is this guy? He's a paganite fellow who had not even seen synagogue from a closer distance or come into the synagogue and listen to any preaching and teaching. With all the details he collected, he just comes and exercises his faith." Wow! Jesus was thrilled. Yeah. What I'm trying to say here is, sometimes, and not sometimes, all the time, you need to wait on the feet of God to taste that miracle. I'm coming back to the original point. Now Jesus gets into the boat and crossed over and came to his own city, where he was there to convey an important doctrine that his ministry is not limited to only miracle works. And miracle workers, if you're listening to me, people who have healing gifts listening to me, don't expect that long queue all the time. The lesser the queue, the bigger is your ministry. Yeah, what principle, what doctrine is this? What nonsense are you talking? Is this what you're exclaiming in your heart? Then you are that false prophet. Why? Because you're running for your own fame, popularity, and glory. This is not what Jesus ran for, man. Jesus, wherever he went, people came thronging on him. Therefore, he had compassion on them, but he did not pre-announce, like how you people build that posters and you hang, no? Miracle meeting. What is that meeting? Healing meeting. This meeting, that meeting, and then you also appoint your actors, yeah, to create that fame. Okay, fine. If you're not a false prophet, if you're a true servant of God, then also you have a lesson to learn. I'm telling the same thing again. The smaller, the shorter the queue that is lined up in front of you, asking for healing touch of God and asking for miracles to happen, asking for demon possessions to be freed and delivered, The longer the queue, the lesser you have done for God. Trust me, I'm telling you the truth. Learn the principle from Jesus. You have done only one half of your ministry. I'm not saying you have not done your ministry. You have done only one half of the ministry. Through this ministry, the important thing that you should convey, I will come to the point a little later. I have a big point to make here, and that's the reason Jesus travels that far to meet a paralytic guy, to not conduct only the miracle, but he conveys something else there. And that's why I'm taking this as a principle, and it applies to me, you, everyone, not only miracle workers, the normal disciples of Christ, normal believers. You also could learn as a principle. I will come to you a little later, but let us deal with first miracle workers. They are great servants of God. I respect them. God bless them. I love them. But you're doing only one half of your ministry. Not all of them, but majority of them. The other half is you don't coach them. You don't train them. You don't admonish them. You don't exhort them that they are also capable to become like you. And God is able to bless them with the same gift and power and authority which you had over the devil that possessed them. Are you conveying that message after you perform every miracle? Oh, brother, the queue is long, you know. That's why I'm not able to convey. You can find all lame excuses, brother. Or you could appoint somebody to, you could coach some 10 brothers who would take them to the side and coach them how to receive such spiritual gifts from God and become like this brother who's able to heal you, this brother who's able to free you from the demon possession, this brother who's able to perform that miracles in your life. I'm talking about the true prophets of God, not about the false prophets. They are out of question. Forget them. We will not do bad mouthing about them, right? We are here to talk about the true principles and the doctrines which we could read from the word of God. Okay. Now, you could appoint another 10 brothers who could take them to the side and coach them, and they take care of the other half of your ministry. Okay, you don't have time. I agree. What are they going to coach them? Hey, you know how brother possessed this gift? You know what was his life? You know what is his testimony? You know how his life got changed? You know how testimonies somebody could tell them and then refer it from the scriptures and teach them and how they could live the transformed life in Christ, and therefore they become like you someday. And what happens? Those 20 people whom you healed become like you, they are going to heal another 20, or not another 20, another 400, each one healing another 20 multiplied by 20, 400 people. And those 400 healing, what? Multiples, right? You got to multiply it. 400 by 400, 1,600 people. Oh my goodness. Can you believe in a matter of decades or years or months, you will see a revival in your place? This is exactly how Paul coached the people who worked with him. Paul was a great leader, well-honored. Why? Because he's a great teacher. He's a great leader. He's a great trainer. And that's why he didn't have to keep on visiting the places. He appointed many people. There are a lot of ministers, including ladies. Aquila and Priscilla also were one of those. Yeah, and a lot of ministers, lady ministers, and there are a lot of ministers who worked with Paul. And at the end of each letter, you will see, I greet this person, that person, that person, this person, Rufus, and all these people, you know, Mark, Rufus, and so many people would come there. All these were people who were coached by Brother Paul, and they were the shining light. They carried that. They were the torch bearers, Bible says. They carried that light and the blessings and the gift which Paul had across the ends of the earth. You understand what I'm saying? So your ministry will be holistic if you are fulfilling the second half, that you got to build miracle workers like you. You got to build healing ministers like you. You got to build people who could fight against the demonic possessions and free the people. And those who got freed will understand it better than anyone. Why? Because they've gone through such an harassment. And the moment you teach the gospel, oh my goodness, I'll tell you, they will be over and beyond you, brother. And again, I repeat that formula. The longer the queue, the lesser you have spoken about Jesus. It's more of you looking for your own fame and popularity, or you love that long queue. Compared to the minister in the neighboring queue. Look at the length of Mikey. All people come to me. Huh? Did you notice? Huh? Secretly, you are having that pride in your heart. Demon possessed brother, today is your chance. Come to light. Okay. Now Jesus goes. Why did I pull up that example? Your ministry is not limited to what you are appointed to do. Your ministry is over and beyond more than what you are appointed to do. That is, coaching and training is something that comes as your additional responsibility, and God will test you in that quality. God won't ask you, did you train that brother? A person whom you healed, did you coach him? How he could become like you? Or how he could become better than like you? Better than you? How he could become more powerful? Did you teach him the law of authority? Did you share your testimony with him that how you got transformed you as a powerful person versus what you were 10 years ago? God won't ask any of these. That's why I'm telling you on God's behalf. This is all part of your responsibility, and you can learn from people like Paul and Jesus, two classic examples. This is exactly what they did. They are not limited to what they enjoy as a gift or fruit or blessing or the happiness or joy, anything. They don't limit it, but they always try to build people. That's leadership quality. And if you're that man of authority who is exercising the powers of authority, you will be the leader. And the main, the prime most important quality of the leadership quality would be, you will start building people. You will not limit yourself. You will start building people. That's technically called as coaching and training, or coaching and mentoring, not training. Coaching and mentoring. The leadership quality by default means coaching and mentoring. They will build people. Like, you know, they are so addicted to this. And it's so contagious, because the people whom they build, no, they will inherit the same principle, and they will start building another 10 people. Oh my goodness, this is how, if this was the quality of every leader in Christian circles and Christian congregations, tell me why we have such a slim percentage of people who walk according to the laws and commandments of God, in doctrines, in the word of God, and why there are very less ministers, why there are very less good teachers and preachers, why there are very less miracle workers. Tell me, where are they gone in this pandemic situation? Yeah? Brother, where were you? If you're asking that question to me, I would say my calling is not miracle and healing ministry. But in this pandemic situation is when God helped me to open the doors for ministry, and I started my ministry. Don't you think that itself is a big achievement that God enabled in my life? I have this big testimony. Pandemic situation, what you did, I started to preach and teach the word of God with the help of my Holy Spirit. And how long I was trained for this? 27 years. What were you doing? I was growing in the word of God. I was grounded and rooted in the word of God. I was analyzing the word of God. And every single scripture is written in my heart. By saying that, definitely I take a lot of pride and boast, but in the Lord, not in me. I don't appreciate for who I am, but I appreciate God for who I am. Coming back here. And behold, they brought to him a paralytic lying on a bed. Jesus definitely knew all of this. It's pre-planned. And he reached to that place with a pre-planned. Always he is, you know, then for the next day's ministry, he plans the previous night itself. He discusses with his father. That's the way how he works, his style of working. You and I can learn that quality from our Lord Jesus. Yes. And behold, they brought to him a paralytic lying on a bed. We will close in another 10 minutes mostly. We will see. I will cover this and we will close. We won't be having time to go through the book of Mark. Lying on a bed, the man is not able to walk. He's paralyzed. And they carried him with that bed. And Jesus, seeing their faith, he was moved in his spirit with compassion, right? What a faith. And this paralytic woman, in the book of John, you will understand, John narratively explains, they have opened up the roof and they have let him down with a bed, which Matthew did not capture. That's the only difference, okay? And but Matthew did capture seeing their faith. Carrying a paralytic woman on a bed is not a big deal. But then they're not able to reach. Recently, they've released a beautiful series. The series name is Chosen. I am sure many of you have gone through it. Wonderful you know, serious. They are beautifully narrated, as if you will see that you are watching something live. And in that, they have shown very well, pictorially, they have narrated it, that they are not able to enter inside, and therefore, how difficult it was to climb up. They didn't have any staircase and all. They have to climb up somewhere, somehow, with that man on the bed. And thank God that they did not make the guy to fall down or something like that in the process of carrying him to the roof. And from the roof, they are letting him down. Can you imagine? It's like a circus. And they didn't have any modern day equipments like, you know, some ladders or something like that. And those days, architecture is not full of concrete, RCC concrete. It's made of normal roof. Very rich people had wooden roof and all that. But RCC concrete and all, it's very rare to see. Yeah, if it was RCC concrete, then how would they have opened the roof? That's where I'm assuming and telling you. The roof was so feeble. It was made of some feeble material like flax or something like that. And therefore, they carefully climbed over. Look at the kind of friends this paralytic guy had got. Wow. Before he got into the paralytic state, I think he was a very, very good man. Built that network of friends and all that. And these guys are all worked up. Today, we are not leaving this place without seeing Jesus. And the people are thronging. They are all in queue. They are saying, get lost, man. We are also having problems. And then they go to the next guy. No, get lost. Get behind. Get behind. Get behind. And they went to the last, they became the last person standing in the queue. And they saw, this is not going to work, dude. And they looked at the paralytic man. Paralytic man is looking at all the four or five friends. Okay, guys, let's leave. The paralytic man says, and these guys say, forget it. Leaving, huh? We are leaving, not without making you walking today. Ah, that's it. They all climbed up, the rough fellows, I think. They probably climbed upon one another and they did some circus and somersault and this and that. And they carried that guy with a bed, massive energy, right? The guy would be weighing at least 60 to 70 kgs minimum. And with the bed and all that, another 10 kgs. 80 kgs, they made it to climb at least some 20, 30 feet roof, or 20 feet at least. And then they opened up the roof and they had some mechanism of tying the bed, because not all of them jumped from the roof. They all would be dead. And Jesus also would have fractured his bones. Imagine, Jesus was sitting right under the roof, right? And they don't want to get into such nonsense. But they had their own methods of opening up the roof carefully and tying the bed by four corners, checking whether it is tied tight enough or not. Else what happens? The guy at least was living while he was paralytic. But now, in the process of letting him down, they would have surely let him down to death. Very funny thing to imagine, isn't it? But these guys were so faithful friends to this paralytic guy. He was blessed, I'm telling you. Beloved, you may be not paralytic. You are all good and healthy and all that. How many friends you have like that? Tell me. You have such people who would come and really, even to the extent of giving their life for you. All these guys, while climbing up, there are higher chances they could have fallen down to death. But they were not worried about themselves. They were really concerned for their friend. Principle number one that you could learn is, it's not important that you're operating all this authority and powers and all that. Do you have some faithful friends who would stand by your side? Believers in Christ, sisters in Christ. Do you have such people? Learn this. They finally let that guy lying on a bed in the lying state. They have let him down. Jesus is suddenly watching. Hey, what? Some difference I'm seeing in the atmosphere. What happened? Because they carefully opened the roof and they're seeing something is, and then he looks up, the bed is coming down. And Jesus said, fine, careful, let that guy down. And that's why Jesus said, seeing their faith, said to the paralytic, you know, seeing their faith, he got amazed, thrilled, happy, joyful. And you know what? History says that was his house, actually. Else they wouldn't have guts to open up someone else's roof. Scholars say this. Because it was Jesus, hey, you don't bother about that. Jesus won't ever be bothered about materialistic things, man. He knows how to repair it. Don't worry. Come on, open it up. If it was someone else's house, that's it. These guys are going to throttle them to death and repair it before you leave my place. Since it was Jesus' place, they took all the more liberty. Forget it, man. Jesus would only appreciate. I'm sure that night, hopefully it did not rain, because it was not so quick to repair, and Jesus might have slept like that and looking up to the sky and thanking God, what a faith today. Anyway, this was my imagination. Coming back to the original point, Jesus seeing their faith. See, Jesus seeing their faith means what? You should stop there. How seeing their faith means what? His heart was bubbled with joy. Why? What made him to bubble with the joy? You need to really get into that imagination. And therefore, you will learn something. How to make this Jesus heart bubble with joy through your deeds. Coming back, lying on a bed. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said to the paralytic, "Son, be of good cheer. Your sins are forgiven." This is exactly the reason why Jesus allowed all this to happen. Why? That's the second half of his ministry. I told you, right? Miracle workers, there is only one half you are doing. Jesus also felt somewhat unholistic. Therefore, he went and allowed this. He said, "The Son of Man." Okay, let's read that, right? At once, some of the scribes and within themselves, this man blasphemes. Why they said that? Why they called Jesus a blasphemer? Because, but Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, "Why do you think evil in your hearts?" Jesus is able to hear that voice. "For which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, arise and walk?" Arise and walk is easier to say. Your sins are forgiven is difficult to say, even for men. I will tell you, brother, if you were to give your enemy 1,000 rupees, you will give, or one, or maybe $100, you will give it. But then the same enemy, if you were to say, "Forgive him with all your heart, mind and soul," you will not be able to do it easily. It may take decades to come out of that bitter thoughts and bitter envy and all that. But it's money. Materialistic blessings are easy to be shared among your enemies. But the spiritual blessings are very tough. That's why it started with Colossians 4:6. That grace, word seasoned with salt. Grace and seasoned with salt. Yeah? What is easy, he's asking? Why do you have evil in your heart? "But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth." What power? How he possessed that power? Because he was submissive to that authority of his Father in heaven, through whom he received these powers, so-called gifts, spiritual gifts. And that's what he's reminding here, that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. Then he said to the paralytic, "Arise, take up your bed and go to your house, man." We will come to that a little later, but we have a principle to learn here. Are you trying to tell me that, oh, only Jesus has the Son of Man? It's limited to Jesus. Many people think it incorrectly, or they meditate incorrectly. Son of Man has the power to forgive sins. If you have accepted Jesus as your Lord of Lords and King of Kings, is the life and the way and the truth, and your knees have bowed down before him, and your tongues have confessed that Jesus is my Lord and Savior, then who are you? You have become another Jesus, beloved. Why? Because you have inherited his character. And Jesus himself told that my desire for you is you should become like me. John 14:12. "Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do." Which also means the words that he spoke, you will also speak. The behavior which he possessed, you will also possess. Yeah? The reactions which he exercised, you will also react the same way. How Jesus spoke, how Jesus walked, how Jesus reacted, you will possess in its fullest measure. "And greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask my name, I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son." Are you all with me so far? So this doesn't apply only to the Son of Man, which is Jesus, but it applies to all the sons of God. Sons of God means angels. Let us talk like this. It applies to all the children of God. And your elder brother is Jesus. We are his younger brothers. You have accepted Jesus, you will be able to forgive anyone, those who sinned against you and against the kingdom of God. You will not judge them. You will not be judgmental. You will not go hard against them. Yet you always realize, I'm the minister of God. You know what powers God gave me. You see how many miracles happen. How dare that guy lifts his little finger to speak against me? He lifts up his heel to kick me. He spits on me. He speaks bad about my ministry. This, that. You get into all sorts of brawls and quarrels and disputes. You're wasting your time. Why? Because you're filled with the demonic wisdom, not heavenly wisdom. Heavenly wisdom tells you the right things to do. Heavenly wisdom comes from above. The authority above will give you the heavenly wisdom. The authority below, that is in the bottomless pit, gives you the demonic wisdom. Demonic wisdom teaches you how to fight, quarrel, brawls, killing, murdering, hurting each other, enmity, slandering, sledging, envy, murmuring, gossiping, complaining, all of these. Jesus was not involved in any of these. He forgave the sins. Principle number one is, if you are under that authority, you will learn how to forgive easily. It is not at all a difficult thing for you. Even if they sin against you or against the kingdom of heaven, both, you will not judge them. Okay, moving on. We are going to close. Then he said to the paralytic, arise, take up your bed and go to your home. What a command. Brother, if you're praying over someone with that authority given to you from above and you have the powers instilled in you, you should exercise with such a great authority, representing the authority, and your talk should be like this. Not only talks, after you talk, the deeds, the works that God performs because of your prayer also should be like this. You're praying over healing, people should be healed. You're praying somebody's job should be restored, they should be restored. You're praying over some families should be united, they should be united. You're praying over some demons should be chased out of your neighborhood, they should be chased. You're praying for your neighbors, deliverance from the bondage, the clutches of the devil, they should all accept Jesus. If it doesn't happen, no. That means, it doesn't mean that you are demonic and all. You have not understood the power of authority, neither have you exercised the powers given to you from above, that authority of heaven to its in its fullest measure. Probably you are partially using it. Probably you are a partial miracle worker or something like that, or a partial believer in Christ. Look at him. And what happens after that? And he arose and departed to his house. Finished. Matter over. Jesus commands, it happens. And that's why I read John 14:12. When you command in the name of Jesus, it must happen. Because why? Jesus himself told, he will do many things more than what I've done. That is God's desire. That is Jesus' desire. And when it will happen? When you start abiding in this law of authority. When you have understood these doctrines and principles encompassed within this law of authority. Now when the multitude saw it, they marveled and glorified God, who had given such power to men. Ah, they looked at Jesus as man, which is okay with Jesus. But he's son of God. But the similar crowd will look at you. Look at his authority, how he exercises. Not that you should become popular, with that we will close. Not that you should become popular for your own fame and glory and honor, but all the fame and glory and honor, you will rather give it to the name of Jesus. And that's why you should always pray from your heart that God should use you mightily, and you should be able to exercise the powers given to you from above, that authority of heaven. And may God bless us. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this wonderful time of fellowship. Thank you for shedding light from your word, O Lord. Through that paralytic man healing incident, we have learned a lot. Help us to exercise the powers in its fullest measure. May God bless us. Amen. Brothers and sisters, please subscribe to our channel. Get access to all our playlist videos. Subscribe and also make others to subscribe, because that's your duty. Be instrument in the hands of God to spread the word of God. Don't force them, but share it, right? Tell them, these many teachings are there. And after that, Holy Spirit will take care. Don't keep on reminding to them. That's not needed. Tell them once and leave it. I'm requesting you to tell or to all your near and dear ones at least once. Thank you. God bless you. I'll see you soon.